So today we're going to be covering the following topics. We'll start with a course overview. We'll have then a look at the history of AI, okay? And finally, we'll take a look at the applications of AI. So a little bit of an introduction about myself. I'm Saeed Ghani. I haven't been a traditional AI person. So in fact, this is the first time I'm actually teaching the course Introduction to AI. I have in the past been teaching courses in the data networks area. So my background is in networks. I have also taught courses in stochastic processes, data communications. For the past few years, I've been teaching a course on deep learning for the Internet of Things, okay? And several of my PhD students are also doing research in AI. So it's been an exciting journey coming into the domain of AI and specifically in machine learning and deep learning. Some of my details are over here. My office is in the 4G building here at the main campus. I also have a city campus office, but hopefully I'll be using this most of the time. My email address, my counseling hours, hopefully I should be there most of the time as specified over here, 11 to 1 p.m. Mondays and Wednesdays. I also have a website, which is the Telecommunications Research Lab. For those of you who might be interested in finding out what my research students are doing, you can take a peek at that. One of my PhD students right now is Nida Sadaf Khan. She's also my head TA. You will also have another TA. So the total will be, you might say, three TAs, as Nida is sort of equivalent to two TAs. She's full-time on this. Her office hours are in the Adamji building. I hope all of you are aware of where that is in breakout six. Email address, counseling hours are right after this class, okay? So that'll be hopefully convenient for you if you want to go and meet her for, you know, homework assignments or get assistance on any aspects. Now let's talk a little bit about the course outline. The course outline has already been uploaded on the LMS. How many of you are already on the LMS and you have accounts? Or rather, is there anybody who does not have an LMS account been able to access the syllabus on that? Nobody. Okay, that's good. So the LMS will be used very heavily. Is there somebody online who is has a comment?
I couldn't find the syllabus on the LMS.
I'm sorry? Can whoever speaking speak up a little bit because I can barely hear you.
Sir, I think you're saying that the syllabus is not on the LMS.
Syllabus is not visible on the LMS. Has anybody accessed the syllabus on the LMS? Nobody? Has anybody tried to access it? But it's not visible? I don't know. I uploaded it several days ago, but I'll double check it. Thanks for pointing that out. Okay. This is the course description. It's a general introductory course on AI. All right. We will be mostly looking at the theoretical aspects of AI. However, the practical aspects of AI will be covered in your homework assignments. All right. So hopefully there will be about half a dozen or so homework assignments once in a fortnight, and you'll be expected to use either Python or whatever your favorite language is in order to do those homework assignments. All right. The prerequisite, of course, is data structures. I hope everybody has passed the course. If you haven't, you may be asked to drop this course at some point by the program office. Course objectives, you can take a look at that. Learning outcomes, I won't go into the details of that. I've already spoken about the hybrid course. My preferred language for your programming assignments will be Python. So I would prefer if you can, this will be formally asked from you, but I would prefer if you can install your favorite IDE for Python. which includes Jupyter and maybe Spider or PyCharm or one of those IDs, okay? So that you can do programming in that and you can do debugging in that as well, okay? Now, this is a list of topics, which is very brief. You can take a look at this and we'll come back to this later on, and we might deviate from this as well to some extent. I mentioned homework assignments. Homework assignments will be negatively marked if you don't submit it on time, okay? Normally what I have is I give you an entire week to submit the homework assignment. You have to upload it, and it is still uploadable for another week. However, for that second week, you will get negative marks as time progresses. Okay, typically about 0.5 marks per day or something like that. If you are caught cheating, in some ways, hopefully not, there will be consequences, okay? And those can be quite drastic, if you know what I mean. So I mentioned the lecture notes. So these lecture notes will be available. So I use a Wacom tablet and I sometimes write on these as well. So I will be, well, sometimes quite a lot. So those notes will be available to you. They'll be uploaded on the LMS. In addition, the recordings will be available to you. Okay, so you don't have to worry about, you know, writing anything unless you, that helps you in learning. The reading assignments, there's this book, which is by Russell and Norvig. However, unfortunately, the most readily available version of that is somewhat dated. It's 2009 or 10. Okay, but surprisingly, it's still by far the most widely recommended book by Stanford, Berkeley, I think even at MIT, even till last semester. Although the fourth edition of this has just recently been has been released, but it's not available online. So it's a bit hard to get hold of. I've ordered it from the library. But anyway, the text is not always, you know, the best way to learn. It's a good, useful thing to have with you and to put under your mattress while you're sleeping or something, but not used all the time. Grading marks will be done as follows. Homework assignments will be the almost the bulk of it, 40%. Final exam will, I hope, be conducted on campus. I really don't like online final exams. Very wary of that. Now, quizzes have to be looked at. I'm not sure if we'll be able to conduct the quizzes, because if quizzes are conducted online, there is the element of cheating. I know IBA students and Pakistani students are generally very, very innovative sometimes. So I'm a little wary of that. So let's keep the quizzes, you know, we'll keep our fingers crossed as far as the quizzes are concerned. So any questions about the course outline or the introduction so far? No? Okay, good. Anything online? Okay, very good. So let's go ahead. Let's start with a historical perspective and a little bit of a discussion, because I would really like this class to be, even though we're somewhat separated by the size of this auditorium, I would like this to be somewhat interactive. Okay, so I would like to have a discussion about what you think is artificial intelligence. Okay, so raise your hands. Unfortunately, people online and the record may not be able to capture your comments, and I'm trying to get a better mic, which perhaps will be placed somewhere over here, which will be able to capture your comments as well. But for now, let's see how well it goes. So let me have your comments. What do you think is AI all about? Okay, G. And please speak a little louder if you want it to be recorded, because it's possible that I might make this entire curriculum available on YouTube, so other people from other universities may also be listening to you. G. Would you like to take off the mask when you speak? Because I know it's a health hazard, but for a few minutes, I think it's worth the risk. G. Okay. To make decisions, okay, so that's a key word. For computers to be able to make decisions based on based on the operations that they're performing. Okay, anything else, GO there? Okay, so something which learns. So that's all about machine learning, right? So machine learning is a buzzword these days. Although not necessarily the complete focus of this course, but it is part of AI. Okay, so learning, G. G. Okay, so predictability. So given a certain amount of data, to be able to predict the future. Okay, very good. G. Mimic human beings, all right, very good. So originally, when AI came about, the idea was that, we're intelligent people, right? We are intelligent humans, we're Homo sapiens, and we're the best of creation. So if computers can mimic us, what could be better than that, all right? So we will be right at the pinnacle of, you might say, intelligence. So that is the idea, that can computers mimic ourselves, okay? Any other thoughts? Okay, so people are familiar with the Turing test, right? I hope all of you are familiar with the Turing test. So there was a lot of philosophical debate about what is intelligence, what are thinking machines, all right? And people could have different ideas about how do you define intelligence. And it wasn't until 1950 that this gentleman, Turing, came up with the idea that here's a simple test that we can devise, which will define whether a computer is thinking or not, or whether it's intelligent or not. In those days, they used to call it thinking machines. Although now we've replaced it with, intelligence or artificial intelligence. So the idea of the Turing test was very simple. You have a human interrogator. On the one side, they've got a computer. And the other side, they have humans, okay? And not through conversation, but through text interaction. All right, you're giving it a bunch of questions and you're getting questions back. So, you don't have that feeling that how long the system is taking to respond, or what the pronunciation is and so on. So you're interacting with both of these systems. And the idea was that if you can't differentiate, let's say you have 10 people you're talking to, and one or two of them are computers. And if you can't figure out which one of those are actually machines, then perhaps you can say that those machines are actually intelligent, okay? Because they can interact with you. And of course, it depends on how long you talk to them. So the early systems that came around, you could talk to them for a few minutes, but immediately after a few minutes, you could figure out, well, this is obviously not a machine, all right? And there are tons of examples of how those chatbots went wrong. Even today, you can't really have a conversation with a good chatbot for more than a few minutes before you realize that it's not really a human being over there, okay? So that was the idea. But then the question was, what are the issues with the Turing test? So as I said earlier, people thought that, being able to mimic a human being was perhaps the best way that you could define intelligence, right? But what were the problems with, just being able to mimic a human being? Are we really, the best of intelligence? Can you define the best of best intelligent creatures to be just us? Or are there problems with that definition? I'm sure that some of you can think of problems with that definition. Are we all perfect? What kind of mistakes do we make? Gee. So we don't have access to a huge amount of data. And so maybe, not having access to that data makes our knowledge limited, all right? So if you can have a computer which has access to, the world of knowledge, then it can be perhaps more intelligent than us, okay? So decision-making or intelligence based on knowledge, okay, G. Sorry? Hamari, maybe, sorry? Infinite neoti. So we have limited capacity, so we forget, right? So what happened 10 years ago, unless you one of those people who can memorize everything, or maybe the guy in Big Bang Theory, Sheldon, who has a memory, which, he remembers everything what happened in his life, which is good and bad as well. So if you have a limited memory, that is generally a bad thing, because, you forget what you taught in the first lecture by the time the final exam comes, right? But is that always bad, by the way? Would you really like to have a foolproof memory that you remember every single thing that happened in your life? Would you like to have that? No, why not? Yeah, bad memories as well. That's one thing. But what else? What is the problem with having too much memory? Some memories are useless, exactly. So what you ate for breakfast, you know, 2 months ago, if you had to, if your memory was cluttered with unnecessary, trivial, unimportant information, then actually you have a problem. And that's sometimes a problem with too much information, right? Sometimes when you go on the internet and you're trying to look up something, you wish that, you know, you just had a concise definition, which is why Wikipedia is very useful. But, you know, if you have a plethora of information, just too much information, then it becomes a problem. Okay, so sometimes you need to have important information, not necessarily all the information. So you don't want, you know, terabytes and gigabytes and zettabytes of information all the way cluttering your memory. Okay, so that's another problem with that humans, perhaps good thing or bad, that humans actually forget. And actually, in some ways, it's good because we would like to forget inappropriate or unpleasant memories. We would like to, you know, keep important things on in our brain, in the forefront of our brain. Okay. What are the problems with humans? Ji. Okay, so there's the issue of disagreement. So then that raises a broader issue whether, you know, is it good to disagree or should you have a communist system like China where everything there's only a single word? Or is democracy good and you have, you know, the Republicans and the Democrats fighting again. So that's debatable. Okay. I'm not going to completely agree with that. Ji. Okay. Very, very pertinent because human beings are people with emotions, right? And we get angry at times. So if one of you ask me a wrong question at times, maybe I'll get angry at you, or maybe somebody who's, you know, providing service online to a customer and the customer is very irritated. Then the caller, then the, you know, the person who is answering the phone will have an incorrect, inappropriate response, right? Which is not good. So being able to control our emotions generally is good, all right? But of course, having human emotions is what makes us humans, right? So emotions are extremely important. In order to be able to understand others, we need to be able to understand their feelings as well, okay? So emotions are perhaps good and bad as well. What are the other problems with humans? Ji. We're prone to mistakes. So that is perhaps the biggest problem, all right? So if you imagine that you had a computer which made all the mistakes that we humans do, mistakes in pronunciation, mistakes in recalling information, mistakes in spelling mistakes, and so on. So you really don't want to have a computer which has all those problems, right? So that, of course, clearly is a big problem with humans, that we're not perfect and we have all of those issues. What else? Ji. Okay, so we have biases, we're prejudiced, and unconsciously all of us are somewhat biased against something, whether we realize it or not, whether it's in the forefront of our brains or not, but we all have some kind of prejudices and biases built in, okay? And unfortunately, most of today's AI, and we're jumping ahead a little bit, which is based on machine learning, which is based on data, also has that problem, okay? Because it's based on data, and data that you're giving it perhaps is also biased, okay? So if you look at the US, for example, and you're looking at what is the probability that a black person is a criminal, will be much higher, inappropriately biased, than a white person, simply because a lot of the data that they have has a lot of blacks which have, you know, are criminals, okay? So this kind of bias creeps into the data as well. Gender bias comes in, okay? All kinds of biases come in with the data. So that is a problem with humans. But again, your points are very interesting, but again, this is also a problem with AI, at least at present, okay? And of course, there are steps to be able to resolve that. And perhaps we'll talk about that more as well as we go on. So what else? What other problems exist with humans? Are we perfect? Somebody said we don't have access to a lot of data, okay? We don't have access to a lot of data, and can you figure out the square root of 17? To the 10th digit, decimal place, okay? Probably not, right? So we can't do advanced computation, So humans, if you're looking at a computer which is mimicking a human being, it's not necessarily always good, all right? Ideally, we don't want, if you want to have thinking machines, if you want to have artificial intelligence, we don't necessarily want to have it with all the baggage that human beings come with, right? Because as you say, it's easy for us, well, we can create other human beings, right? We know how to do those. We can produce babies. We don't necessarily need a computer to be able to have all that, those issues as well. So we're looking for computers to actually assist human beings, okay? And so we want them not only to have some of the capabilities that we have, we don't want them to have the problems, the baggages that we come with, and we want them to have more than what we have in some ways, okay? So if you look at this particular diagram over here, it tells you that there are some parts which of human behavior, okay, which are unintelligent, okay? And we saw an example of that is typing mistakes, okay? Some parts that intelligent behavior that humans don't have, all right? So we can't solve difficult math problems, okay? And of course, there are some parts where we are intelligent, and that's the useful portion of the Turing test, okay? So Turing test has its issues. Now, there are three types of AI, generally speaking, okay? As we've already discussed, there is narrow artificial intelligence, okay? That is something that we're all familiar with, that computers can do specific tasks, okay? Whether it's self-driving, whether it's Siri, whether it's getting predictive learning and so on. So all of that is very specific. And then there's of course the artificial general AI, okay? And general AI is something that of course, there's huge debate whether or not we will ever actually achieve it. And general AI simply means that computers will have the same level of capabilities that we have, okay? That doesn't necessarily mean that they have all the negative aspects of humans, but essentially that they'll be self-aware. Okay, big topic of science fiction movies today, these days. And then of course, there's the super intelligence, which says that all of those movies which talk about the Terminator coming back and killing the human beings and so on, all of that is. So today we are, right now the world is in narrow AI, okay? And of course, anything beyond that is debatable. And of course, there is a lot of debate, not from today, but right from the start of AI. Right from the 50s and 60s, people have been debating and thinking about whether at any point will we have general AI or whether there'll be super intelligence as well or not, okay? So there has been a debate on the issues of strong versus weak AI, okay? Which is the narrow and the general AI, okay? And one of the persons who's been at the forefront of this debate has been a gentleman called John Searle. Interestingly, he's a professor of philosophy and not computer science at Berkeley. And so he, in 1980, he questioned the notion of strong AI, okay? And he basically, his argument was that we will actually never really have strong AI. In other words, computers will never really be able to have self-awareness, okay? And his logic was as follows, and he gave the argument which was referred to as the Chinese room argument, okay? And Chinese can be replaced by any language that you or I don't understand, okay? So let's assume that all of us don't understand Chinese, okay? So the thought experiment, this is again a thought experiment because he's a philosopher. And so now we're looking at a little bit about at the philosophical aspects of AI, okay? So basically said that, consider yourself inside a box, okay? So you're this gentleman over here, and you have an input, an output, okay? And on the input side, you're getting questions written in Chinese, okay? So somebody is asking questions, they're writing down in Chinese script. And as you are, I'm sure all of you are aware, Chinese script is extremely hard to understand, okay? So you have a Chinese script coming in, you understand the syntax, okay? You can figure out how to respond to that by having some kind of a lookup, some kind of a rule-based technology, okay? It could be based on deep AI, deep learning, or what have you, all right? But somehow you don't really understand what's written on that piece of paper, but you do know that I can look it up and I can respond to that. Okay, you look that up, you get a piece of paper which has the answer, okay, and you give it at the output. Okay, and his argument was that computers, no matter how sophisticated they get, they can't really understand the semantics of what was being written in that question. Now today, of course, we have semantic networks as well. Okay, so there's a lot of AI research going on in semantic networks to be able to build in that meaning inside the words. Okay, so well, this was 1980, but still today, even today, a lot of people believe that strong AI is not possible simply because it depends on how you define thinking and intelligence. Okay, so basically what he's saying is that computers can't really understand the meaning of things. Okay, if you're writing something down, they can understand the syntax of that and they can respond to that, but they don't really have the deeper understanding of the meaning which we as human beings understand. Okay. However, on the other side, there's a flip argument. Okay, some people say that, well, the brain is simply a bunch of neurons. And if you can replicate all the neurons in a computer, then the brain is simply the hardware, right? The programming, all the software can be replaced. And if you can replicate all of that on a different hardware, it's not going to be biological, but it's going to be on a piece of computer, on a CPU or a GPU or what have you, then you can replace, then it can have intelligence as we define it, okay? So the debate is you know, the jury is still out. Everybody has their own opinion, and you can perhaps debate that amongst yourself as well, okay? It's an interesting debate. And there are, of course, a variety of different reasons why people think that it could be, you know, theological reasons, why people have beliefs that, you know, humans are created unique, and a lot of other reasons as well, okay? So this was a little bit of the philosophical aspects of AI, okay? Now let's talk a little bit about the rise of AI, the historical view. All right, and let me make sure how the timeline is going. Okay, so there are lots of nice material available on YouTube. I would recommend some of these to you. There's one which I was looking at the other day, which was a complete detailed interview with some of the earliest researchers in this area and the kinds of experiments that they did. It was absolutely fascinating. So I would strongly recommend that. But as I said, Alan Turing was one of the few people that came up in the 50s. Then there was John McCarthy, who coined the term artificial intelligence. There was this Lisp machine, which was created at MIT by John McCarthy. 50s, 60s were the rise. There were things like Eliza, which was sort of like a chatbot, a very primitive version of the chatbot, which was created way back in the 60s. Some of you might have heard of the 2001 the Space Odyssey, where the robot HAL goes out in space and starts to be, you know, becoming self-aware and wants to preserve himself. And as a result, he kicks out the human being. And then there was a lot of research in the 60s about knowledge representation. How do you actually store the data? Okay, and there's still a lot of work going on in knowledge representation, as we'll talk about later. You must have seen this before. This one of the gurus of early AI, Arthur Samuel, who was able to program the IBM computer to play checkers. Then the 70s had some problems. Okay, the 70s, there were people like Marvin Minsky at MIT, who headed the MIT AI lab. And he was a cognitive scientist. So a lot of the research going on AI is people who are neuroscientists, okay? Because a lot of times, actually, some of the best algorithms that humans have invented actually have biological inspiration. And AI today, neural networks and deep neural networks have biological, you know, the brains is the inspiration for that. So some of the best researchers came from the area of neuroscience and cognition, okay? But the expectations, you know, there is a hype curve. You must have been familiar with the hype curve, right? So there's always a hype curve. And as soon as a new technology comes, people start having unrealistic expectations. And that's still going on, by the way, all right? So Marvin Minsky in 1970 predicted in 3 to 8 years, you will have a machine with general intelligence, okay, of an average human being, All right. So obviously, when people are making such outlandish predictions, there was had to be what is called an AI winter. In other words, there was a downturn in the industry, which led to the fall of AI. And people realized that the biggest problem is scalability. The hardware wasn't there. Okay. The kind of data that we have today wasn't there at that time. Okay. People had problems with neural networks was still there. So neural networks have been around for quite a while. But there were problems in being able to program neural networks, being able to do things like what I've called backpropagation algorithms. Those were invented by that time. All right. And so because you didn't have all of this, you quickly ran into a lot of problems. And as a result, you had the first AI winter. So as you can see from this curve, you can see that there was the first rise of AI, and then the first AI winter, then the second rise of AI, the second AI winter. And now today we can be considered as we're going through the third rise of AI. And since the 90s, it's fortunately still rising. Okay. But people have their fingers crossed as to whether there's going to be another AI winter in the future or not, because again, the hype has really gone through the ceiling. So in the second rise, you had the expert systems coming in. Okay, so expert systems, computers like the Lisp machines came in. A lot of investments came in, and people again had unrealistic expectations. And then, of course, they had the second AI winter over here. And again, a lot of the funding from government agencies dropped. Okay. And then the third rise of AI was from 93 onwards. And here, some of the basic algorithms were developed, and which is going to be the core of this particular course. Okay. While we're going to be talking about machine learning and deep learning a little bit, but that's not really what this course is about. Hopefully you're going to be taking more courses in machine learning and deep learning where you learn all the fancy stuff, okay? But as far as this course is concerned, we want to spend more time on some of the basics. So this was where things like probabilistic reasoning, machine learning, intelligent agents came in. And so we'll be spending a lot of time on some of those algorithms, some of those early algorithms, okay? So in the late 90s, 97, you must have heard of this. Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov at chess. This wasn't based on deep learning, which is the rage now, but this was based on a lot of data. So it would play against itself and build up a lot of historical information. And then of course, since 2012 till today, we've seen the rise of AI, okay? And we saw the return to artificial neural networks in 1996. And the biggest the inflection point was in 2012, okay? In 2012, what happened was there was a deep learning architecture, which was called AlexNet, which came out of University of Toronto. That actually led the deep learning boom. And basically what happened was that there's this ImageNet competition, which was existing before that. And the idea was that, can you classify and correctly predict the classification of images, right? And naturally in the past, human beings are best at that, okay? But in 2012, for the very first time, the deep learning algorithms actually were better than human beings, okay? Well, not exactly better, but they had a big improvement in terms of the past algorithms. The past algorithms, which were based on the traditional machine learning algorithms, there was a big improvement, all right? And then all of a sudden people realized, hey, there's something going on, okay? And immediately after that, what you saw was that image recognition led the way, CNN architectures, convolutional neural networks, and other algorithms came in. And they were able to actually do better than human beings in terms of categorizing pictures, which if you think about it, is quite amazing, all right? Then there were other things happening. There was something called a generative adversarial networks, GANs come in, okay? Perhaps some of you have heard of that. Other algorithms came in, deep reinforcement learning. The reinforcement learning was actually an old technology that had been there for quite a while, but then people applied deep learning to that, okay? And then you saw all kinds of things happening. For example, chess became, you know, the world champions were beaten at chess, the world Go champion. And Go is a very difficult game as compared to chess. It's got, the complexity is far more than chess. And people at one point thought that if computers can really play Go, because the kind of complexity that exists in that is way beyond even the best computers can actually fathom. Okay, so, you know, the, in terms of complexity there, it's more complex than the number of atoms in the universe, for example. Okay, so it was thought that if computers can play Go, then they probably really have, you know, real intelligence. Okay, and that was, you know, one of the goals, and that happened in 2016. That AlphaGo, which came out of DeepMind, which was a company owned by and purchased by Google some time back, and they beat the reigning champion of Go at that time, Lee Sedol. All right. And then 2019, you know, the Turing Award was given to people in deep learning. But of course, the fear of another AI winter still exists, all right? And there are lots of people who believe in that, that there's a problem coming up. So here's Lee Sedol, chap in, I think, based out of Hong Kong, who was beaten. And there's some really nice videos, you can look at that. And then, of course, this, a lot of investments start coming in. So if you look at the big companies, Google, Facebook, Microsoft, Apple, all started left and right to buy companies which were basically AI companies, okay? Because they realized that you can't really progress today without having AI. Now, why was deep learning, as you said, neural networks were around for a long time, right? Now, why did deep learning click in 2012? It wasn't because the algorithms were so new, but there were two things happening that led to deep learning being really successful. The first thing that happened, and of course that's a trend, and you're all familiar with Moore's law, which says that every 1.5 to 2 years, you know, computing power, communications power, you know, things like that double. All right. So if you look at this, you look at the number of transistors on a computer on a single chip. Is going from, and here you can see that this is 1,000, 10,000 is going up in log, right? So you're adding a zero in every one of these steps. And these are the actual computers on the horizontal over here, all right? And on the horizontal axis, you have the years. So from 1970 till 2015. Now, if you expand this and you go way back to 1940 to 2020, you can do that if you have the data. This Moore's law is actually still applicable, which is quite amazing, right? So a lot of times people thought that there was going to be a flattening of the curve, that at some point, you know, we just can't have an exponential growth in terms of how many transistors you can put on. There's going to be some limit at some point, right? People still feel that there is going to be some limit at some point, right? But so far it's been going on. And as a result, we had an inflection point, right? So at some point, computers became powerful enough and GPUs came in, all right? I hope all of you are familiar with GPUs. And those are graphical processing units which are used mostly in gaming. And they started being used in deep learning, all right? And as a result, deep learning became extremely powerful and was usable. The other big thing was that deep learning is based on data. The more data you give, the better it performs. And as we know, data has been going through an exponential explosion for a long time. And if you look at this, this is showing you in zettabytes, okay? So zettabytes are 10 to the power 21, okay? Pretty big number. And in terms of the number of zettabytes, if you look at 2020, that's going up to 40 zettabytes, okay? So those are huge numbers. And the basic difference between the deep learning algorithm and the traditional machine learning algorithm was as follows. If you look at performance on the vertical axis over here, and if you look at data, then traditional machine learning algorithms, although they initially did very well, so if you gave them a little bit of data, they would do actually better than other algorithms, other neural network based algorithms. But as you gave it more and more data, they would level off, okay? There was a limit to how much data, you give it a zettabyte of data, it's probably not going to help. Right, terabyte is good enough. So the performance would level off. Neural networks, on the other hand, artificial neural networks would do a little better, but not really that well, okay? deep neural networks, and we'll understand what deep neural networks means in a few minutes, basically have this property that the more data you give it, the performance keeps on improving. Okay, so eventually this is probably going to have some kind of a leveling, but so far the kinds of architectures that people have come up with, they haven't really seen that. All right, so it's quite an amazing thing. The more data you're giving it, the more accurate the performance becomes. Okay, so you know, the more data you have, the data explosion basically favors this particular algorithm. Now, sometimes people get confused. How does deep learning fit into machine learning, to fit into AI? So this particular picture makes it clear, all right? So AI is the big picture, all right? Machine learning is focused on, is a subset that is focused on learning through data, okay? So the more data you have, the better, all right? And deep learning is a subset of that, and it has a specific architecture which is based on the human brain, okay? It uses neurons and neural networks, okay? So, and by the way, generally, in these PowerPoint presentations, which will be uploaded, I will give you links at the bottom. So you're welcome to click on those links and you will get more information from those links. A lot of the times they're articles, some of the times they're YouTube lectures, which can be very useful if you just want to relax and listen to them. So let's spend a little bit of time understanding deep neural networks. They're based on the human brain. Okay, and as we understand, human brains consist of neurons, all right? So this can be thought of as a neuron. This is something which links the neurons, and the links are called synapses, okay? The number of neurons determines the complexity. So human beings have about 100 billion neurons in our brain, okay? And you might think, are those neurons all heavily interconnected? Are they connected to every other neuron, or are they very sparsely connected? And the answer is on the screen, by the way. So any thoughts? When you're born as a baby, do you think you have the same number of neurons? 100 billion neurons? No or yes? Well, yes is the correct answer. You have the number of neurons in the brain doesn't really change that much. So you're born with the same number of neurons. Although frog will have a lot less neurons, all right? So if you look at this particular slide over here, it'll tell you that a sponge, for example, over here at the bottom, over here, has extremely small number of, I don't know, it's 10 to the power minus 2, but somewhere really small. A leech, for example, has larger number of neurons. And again, this is an exponential. Human beings have approximately 10 to the power 11 neurons, all right? And the complexity of deep neural network architectures right now is over there, all right? So we have neural network architectures which have about a million or 10 million neurons. So we're getting close to the level of humans, all right? But of course, you might say we're at the level of a bee, or maybe getting to the level of a frog, the kind of intelligence that a frog that one might expect have, okay? But the synapses, which are the interconnections, those are the things that build up. So as a baby learns, all right, so the first time that a baby actually learns through the hard way that fire is dangerous, or that going down the steps is dangerous, that's where the feedback comes in, all right, and it creates synapses. So those interconnections between neurons is where the learning comes in. That's where the memory comes in. So when you started to recognize your mother, when you were small, it was because your senses gave information to your neurons, and it developed synapses. It developed interconnections. And that's where basically memory is. And what happens when your grandmother or grandfather becomes very old and is not able to learn anything, they keep forgetting. What happens is, are the neurons dying, or do you think they've lost the ability to make synapses?
They've lost the ability to make synapses.
It's synapses. They've lost the ability to actually make the synapses because, you know, it's the synapses which are causing the memory. Okay, so they still have a lot of neurons, but they can't be interconnected. Okay? G. Sorry? We don't use the neurons? We are using the neurons, of course. So neurons, but neurons are connected using synapses. So those connections are important. But neurons, of course, are a very critical component, of course, they're actually doing all the action. So when a signal comes into the neuron, it has an activation. And if that activation happens, then it triggers a response. And that's how you actually do, for example, if you're getting something through your eyes and then you decide something to move your motor arm, then all of that is going through the neurons. So both of these are, of course, important. But the memory is in the synapses, okay? So this is a very simplistic view of what a deep neural network looks like. And it's a simplistic approximation to the human brain. Okay, so the human brain is far more complex. In fact, today, nobody really knows how brain works, in truth, okay? It's far too complex, but we have some idea. And artificial neural networks have tried to, in a very simplistic way, try to duplicate what a brain does, okay? And they have inputs over here, they've got neurons. So these interconnections are the synapses, okay? And these neurons are, of course, playing a very fundamental role. They're interconnecting and then they're passing on the signals. And the depth of the neural network, the deep neural network, simply comes in by having deeper layers, okay? So all of these are interconnected and eventually you have an output, okay? So this is basically what a deep neural network is today. And this is what all the, the fascination about AI that exists today is all about, okay? And these are the kind of architectures that exist today. All right, so the number of layers and the accuracy has been changing. So if you look at the vertical axis over here, this is showing you the accuracy of some of these networks. So in 2010, the accuracy was perhaps somewhere around 25 to 30% in terms of, for example, recognizing an image or categorizing an image. And somewhere as the networks became deeper and deeper, as you can see, this was a shallow network. It became 8 layers deep. Then today, some of the networks are 152 layers deep, okay? So their performance continued to improve. So the accuracy, sorry, this is not accuracy. This is actually loss. I got that wrong, okay? So the accuracy is improving, or one upon accuracy is this. The loss is actually decreasing. So you can think of this as 1 minus accuracy. So 7% is the inaccuracy. So, and at some point, over here, this is where humans were performing in terms of being able to recognize an image, because the images sometimes are very confusing. You know, it's hard to figure out whether it's a car or it's a truck, all right? And especially if the image is very, very small. So at some point, these networks were actually doing better than human beings, okay? And today that's the fact. This is, as you can see, humans were performing at 5.1%. And today you have, in 2017, you had deep neural networks which could actually do better categorization of images than human beings, okay? So now let's talk about the applications of AI. We are running out of time. We do have another 20 minutes. Okay, that's good. So let's look at the applications of AI, and AI, machine learning, as well as deep learning, okay? And as we talk about this area, and specifically machine learning, because that comprises the bulk of what's going on today, there are 4 types of machine learning that is useful to know, all right? There is the supervised machine learning, where you're basically learning by example, all right? Somebody's actually telling you, if you're trying to categorize an image, somebody's got labeled data. You say that this is a truck, this is a car, this is a frog, this is a deer, and using that, you train the network, okay? You train the neural network. Then there is the unsupervised portion. And you might think, well, what do you mean by unsupervised learning, right? How can a machine learn without being told what is correct and what is wrong? Okay, and the answer is right there, is being able to learn patterns, okay? Now, you don't need to tell computers or machines how to be able to distinguish patterns. That's an interesting thing. You don't have to tell it. And that becomes very advantageous. And you look at some examples later on. And then there's semi-supervised, which is a combination of both supervised as well as unsupervised learning, all right? Where you're actually taking best of both. And then there's another category, which is called reinforcement learning. And a lot of the advances, for example, in games, for example, when computers learn to play chess, or beat Lee Sedol in, you know, AlphaGo was based on reinforcement learning. All right, because basically in reinforcement learning, what you have is a goal. For example, in chess, you either lose or win. All right, if you have a game of Atari, you have some score which is telling you how well you're doing. Okay, so that score or that winning or losing is basically telling you whether you're going in the right direction or not. So that's called reinforcement learning. Okay, so let's take a look at number of applications of AI today. And these will be in a different bunch of different areas. NLP, for example, natural language processing, which is a very important area. This deep learning, we've already talked about that. Expert systems, computer vision, of course, extremely important area. So how many of you have, of course, used Google Photos? So let's take a few examples. This is of my personal family. So that's a couple of my grandkids, Jibril and Suleiman. That's my son, Saad. There's Dr. Ishrat Hussain, who comes up on my search. I'm sure you're familiar with him. He was the executive, the director, dean and director for two terms from 2008 to 16. And he's the one who's responsible for most of the development that you see at IBA today. If you came here before Dr. Ishrat came in, this housed pigeons, lots of pigeons in this particular auditorium. So thanks to him. So when you do a Google search, what's going on over here? Can you tell me, there are a couple of things happening over here. So you see at the top, you see that when you go into people search, it's already found some of the people in my life, okay? And it's already told me, and this label wasn't originally there. I labeled it, okay? But it gave me all the pictures corresponding to a particular person. So for example, if you look at this, if I click on my son's image, it shows me all the pictures of my son, okay? And these are in all kinds of, look, facial angles. So this particular picture over here is at a side angle. In this picture here, he's wearing a helmet. Here he's wearing dark glasses. Here, you know, so you can see, and at different ages. So this is when he was younger. I've got pictures of my daughter when she was 3 and still able to recognize that, the 3-year-old and the 30-year-old today are the same person. So now, what do you think, which machine learning is going on? Is it supervised learning? Is it unsupervised learning? Is it reinforcement learning? Is it semi-supervised? What's going on over here? It's unsupervised, right? Why is it unsupervised? Because it's finding patterns, it's clustering the data. Okay, what it's seeing is that it's basically saying that all of these features of this particular human being are similar to each other, but they're different from features of another person. Okay, so it's able to say that, okay, if you look at all the features, and the feature space can be extremely complex, all right? It's not 2-dimensional, it's not 3-dimensional. It probably has millions of dimensions, maybe not millions, but thousands of dimensions, all right? So it's in that 1,000-dimension space, it's able to figure out that some of these features are closer to each other and other persons are further away, all right? So if you look at this, person, it's able to say that all the features over here and here, even though they're 2 babies, they are different because perhaps we get confused at times, all right? But there are some features which are perhaps may not be visible to us. And these could be, you know, small features in the how the eyebrows are formed or how the nose is or the teeth or the ear or the chin, the shape of the chin or what have you. And it's able to recognize that these are 2 different individuals, all right? And that's the whole area of clustering. And that's all based on unsupervised learning. And the beauty of unsupervised learning is that you don't have to train it, all right? The most difficult part of machine learning is if you have to go in and train your data. So if you have millions of images, I'm sure all of you, if you look up on your Google, in your mobile phones, you have thousands and perhaps tens of thousands of images, right? If you had to label each one of them with who is who, it would be a nightmare, right? So it's a lot more convenient if the clustering algorithm can kick in automatically. It can figure out that these people all are similar. And now all it wants you to do is label them. And that's part, of course, of the supervised learning, that you actually go in and say, well, this particular person is, you know, Jibreel, or this is Dr. Ishir, and so on. Now, sometimes you also see this. What's going on over here? Same or different person? Have people seen this in Google Photos? What's going on over here? That's supervised learning, right? So Google is taking advantage of us as customers, and instead of having its own people do the difficult task of actually doing the labeling, it simply asks us, and we sometimes are very happily we comply and help Google, right? So we're basically helping Google over here by saying that this is the same or different person. Okay, so you might say this is semi-supervised because it's got clustering, which is unsupervised, and then it's got supervision as well. But actually, semi-supervised is a little bit more complex, and we haven't really talked about that. But there, actually, the entire algorithm itself is based on a combination of unsupervised and supervised learning, and that's a little bit more complex. We haven't really talked about that. Okay, but this particular portion, you can take where you actually saying that these two persons, are they the same person or the different person? Because what's really happening is in that space, it's got a little bit of an overlap, right? It's obviously a continuous to some extent. Human beings are not completely discrete. It's not like person A and person B are going to be completely different. There are going to be at times where two people are very similar. So for example, this particular person over here, by the way, is not... is my other son, okay? So it confused my elder son with my younger son. So this is Saad and this is Wes. And why do you think it got confused? Because the gene pool is the same, right? So both are, the parents are the same. So somewhere, even though we might not see it, there's some resemblances in the features for both the sons, which are similar, all right? And it may not be obvious to us, but sometimes it's obvious to the computer. So basically what's happening is that here, this is an example of supervised learning where Google is actually asking you to help it being able to differentiate between person A and person B. So now it knows in the future that these two persons, were, this particular feature actually corresponded to this individual, okay? And so it is becoming more intelligent, all right? You're actually training Google's deep learning algorithm to become smarter and smarter every time you do this. And you can see a lot of that on social media where you're being asked to be able to differentiate, okay? So the bottom was the clustering and the top was the supervised learning, okay? Now you can also do this. You can search. So for example, if I go onto my Google Photos and I say bird on water, so it will combine all the pictures, will pick from my Google, you know, I've got probably thousands of pictures. It'll pick all the pictures of birds and water, okay? Now, what do you think is going on over here? How do you think it did that? Is it unsupervised? It is supervised? It's got supervised. Is there some unsupervised things going on over here as well? So, there are a couple of things going on over here. First of all, it was able to figure out that all of these birds, for example, are a single cluster, all right? But it didn't know what it was called, right? Like, it didn't know that my son was called Saad, all right? I had to label it. So once it had all the pictures of a person or all the pictures of a bird or all the pictures of water, it was able to cluster it, and that was unsupervised learning. But then somebody had to say, okay, this is water and these are birds. So somebody had to do the labeling. So when that labeling was done, then all of a sudden it knows what is water, and it knows that this cluster of features is all water, right? It knows that all of this cluster of features, which may correspond to beaks, which may correspond to feathers and flying and so on, all of that correspond to birds, okay? So now when you say birds and water, now I didn't actually go in and label these pictures, which I took, and nobody's seen those before. I didn't actually label them as birds and water. And that's a big difference. In the past, you used to have to label things. But now it's intelligent enough that it knows, because in Google's labeled data set, it has those things. It has date. It has. It knows what a water. It knows what birds are. But of course, it doesn't know everything. So if you have, for example, you know, maybe a camel or a goat, which is not something that you find in the West, it might get confused because it may not have a lot of training data for that. Okay. But if you have common words which are there in its data set, which has already been trained, it can simply put those together and be able to search for those. Right? Or picture captioning. So now what's happening over here? So you give it a picture and it's able to say man in black shirt is playing guitar. Quite interesting, huh? It knows that the person is wearing it. It's not like hanging somewhere. It also knows that the person is playing the guitar because of the way it's holding the guitar. He's holding the guitar. The other picture is construction worker in orange safety vest. In orange safety vest is working on the road, right? So imagine the kind of learning that it has is that it is a construction worker. Why? Because he has a safety vest. He's working. He's got a helmet on. He's working, and he's working on the road. Right, so this is all done automatically using Stanford's AI. Another one, two young girls are playing with a Lego toy. So it's able to identify that these are number one girls, okay, not boys. These are young. I presume one of them is kind of young. They're playing with toys. It was able to recognize toys. So now what do you think is going on over here? Is it supervised, unsupervised? Combination. So unsupervised is definitely coming in because it's able to recognize what is a guitar. Okay. That previous portion where I said that it's able to recognize things, but now it's going beyond that. It's not only learnt the words, but it's found the association with them, that the person is wearing the vest, not, you know, lying on it. They're playing with the toys, the age of the child, the fact that the person is playing with the guitar. So now how do you think it was able to understand that? Do you think it was unsupervised or supervised learning? How do you think it was supervised learning? Ji, aap bataiye. Okay, what kind of labeling do you think it had to be able to learn this? Reinforcement learning? Ji, sorry? Supervised learning and what kind of, give me examples of a super, how would you train, how would you train an AI machine to be able to do image captioning? Very good, very good. So basically what as was explained is that now you're training it with actually captionings. So this is not easy again, all right? And this is again an area where, for example, if you look at self-driving, there's a lot of issues because imagine the amount of captioning that one has to do on the road. And in fact, one of my PhD students is actually working in this area. He's helping being able to do image captioning so that can be used by self-driving cars like, you know, Waymo and Tesla to be able to recognize what's going on the road. They'd like to be able to figure out whether a person is crossing the road or whether he's lying on the road or whether he's standing on it or is he running across and so on. So image captioning is becoming extremely important, but it requires a lot of supervised data, right? So there are databases with millions of data where it's been captioned. So you would have maybe 100 or, you know, several hundred instances of a man in black or a woman in red, or a person playing guitar, or kids playing with toys, or person working on the road, or people wearing vests and so on. So after it's been trained on thousands and millions of captioned images, it's now been able to do the captioning. Okay, so this is another level of complexity that is already there. Okay, G. Okay, very good. So you have labeled data with boys and girls. Okay, so you may not be able to, it's kind of it's becoming harder and harder these days to be able to figure out who's a boy and who's a girl and what is the general inclination of that person. Sometimes boggles my mind, but you have labels today, all right? So if you have a label, if you've got 1,000 images of men, a million images of boys, a million images of girls in different positions, boys, girls, toddlers and all of that, then it can very easily recognize whether this is a boy or a girl, or whether it's a toddler, and so on. But of course, at a young age, it will make mistakes. Just like the example I gave you that it made mistakes, okay? So it's not necessarily that the image captioning is always right. These are some good captions. I've seen a lot of bad captions, right? You come to my PhD student and it'll show you a lot of bad captions as well. So let's try to end in the next few minutes. So here's a bunch of examples that I'll just throw these at you. And these are available if you want to look at these in more detail. Recommendation engines, huge amounts of money going in over there. And we'll perhaps talk about these more. Netflix, every time you go onto YouTube, it's based on recommendation engines. Healthcare, for example, IBM Watson is using healthcare. One of my PhD students, Nida, in fact, your TA, she's working on an application of AI where she is using sensors to be able to detect OCD. OCD is one of those behaviors where people have some kind of obsession, okay? So she's using that, and that's a PhD research area. DeepMind is working in this area. Social media is being used a lot in social media, of course, for image tagging. Twitter is using this all the time to be able to figure out what you're saying, sentiment analysis, predictive search. So as soon as you start typing something based on your location, your personal data, Google can actually predict what you want to say. Okay, so that completion is based on some data about yourself as well. Natural language processing, it's a big area. Alexa and Google Assistant, some of those become very popular. Self-driving cars, we've already spoken about that. A lot of research going on this area in self-driving. Waymo, which is Google's version of self-driving, is competing against Tesla based on data. Space exploration is coming in. Applications in finance, a lot of applications, finance, agriculture. So we've spoken about a lot about the fancy aspects of AI, right? The deep learning and machine learning parts. But there is, this course is not necessarily going to be focused on all of that. Okay, that's just to give you an idea of what AI is all about. There are other applications. For example, if you're using Google Maps, right? If you want to get from city campus to the main campus or from your home to one of the campuses, it uses search algorithms. So in the next lecture, we'll start off with how do you actually do something basic as that, okay? We'll build up on that. We'll eventually perhaps get to machine learning. How do you detect spam, all right? So these are applications of probabilistic reasoning. You'll have to understand how probability works, okay? Applications of something called Markov decision processes. And that has a lot of applications in the financial industry. What kind of investments do you make? So those are the applications that we'll start off with, starting next week, okay? And then we'll build up to the more sophisticated and fancy aspects of deep learning, okay? So with that, let me thank you all for this session, and I hope to see you on Thursday. Thank you.